Hello everyone, and welcome to my first official video for a new Godot project I'm working on. This will be an ongoing devlog style series for a real-time strategy game I'm building. As you can see in the demo that is playing right now, this is still very early days. I have purely been concentrating on the game mechanics, and up until yesterday even the tanks were just blocks. That really is all you need when fleshing out game mechanics. While it's obviously nice to have things look good, you can easily lose days, if not weeks, that are better spent first proving your game will actually work. There are also a bunch of things in here that I've done for the very first time, so there are bound to be better ways of dealing with some of those. As time goes on, we will improve on those things. Today I want to spend a few minutes going over how the project is currently structured, and then spend a minute on the water effect, as some people have been asking about that. Let's start within project settings. We will set up our layers first. I really like this new feature in Godot 3 where you can name the layers. In our render layers, anything in layer 1, the default layer, will be rendered by all cameras we have. Layer 2 will be used for things that should only be shown on our minimap, and layer 3 will be used for things that should only be rendered on our main camera. For our physics layer, we're using categories for things in our world. Our terrain, our obstacles, friendlies, enemies, and projectiles. Now I'm using the physics engine sporadically here. A lot of the logic doesn't require advanced physics. You can also see I'm loading a few scripts on the autoload tab. This allows us to have a few things loaded in memory that are globally accessible. Great for stuff that need to be accessible from many places and are required to keep state. We'll be expanding on this as time goes on. Let's have a look at our folder structure. I've created a number of folders to organize my project into. First, we have an ammo folder. In this folder, I'm placing all the script and scene files that relate to the various projectiles in the game. The Blender folder isn't used for the Godot project. Here I place the source Blender files for various assets, but Godot doesn't see those. This is just there to keep everything together. The Buildings folder is currently unused. In here, I will eventually place all the scripts and scenes for buildings that you can place within the game, but that is for later. The Levels folder will contain all the different levels. This is the first folder that follows a pattern we'll have for many things in the game. In the root of this folder, we find a script and scene that form the basis of our level structure. In our subfolder Test, we find our test level, which inherits from our base level. Our level currently consists of a grid map for the terrain, some obstacles, and a few enemy units. The Miscellaneous folder is where I place everything that doesn't fit anywhere else. The Textures folder contains all the textures I use directly within the game, such as our HDRI and the texture for our seabed. The Tilesets folder contain our tilesets used by our grid maps. I realize that tileset might not be the best fitting name. I will do a follow-up video soon where I'll show my workflow for creating these tilesets. Finally, we have our Units folder. This again follows the approach of having a script and scene with all our basic logic and subfolders in which we'll place individual units. For now, we just have our test units in our test folder. Now let's look at our water shader. I'm cutting a few corners with it, but it'll show some basics of writing shaders in Godot. Note that I lost a few settings that I need to reset, and that the editor is currently not showing the water as transparent. I think this is due to using the viewport output directly. I'll show it from the camera perspective later on. At the start of our shader, we define our shader type as a spatial shader. This is used for 3D rendering. For this particular shader, I'm also turning writing to the depth buffer off. On the next two lines, we define our first two uniforms. Uniforms are variables that we can set from outside of our shader. You will see them represented as material properties. The first variable provides a base color for our water, which is our color blue. The second variable allows us to set a texture map. Our texture map is a map that instead of colors contains offsets that we can use to create a ripple effect in our water. The DUDV map that I'm using here came from a video on the YouTube channel Thin Matrix. He has some really nice tutorials for OpenGL development on his channel, so go check him out. The next two uniforms are used to change the speed and size of our waves. After this, we have a varying variable. Shaders for 3D materials have three processors. a vertex processor that is run for each vertex, a fragment processor that is run for every pixel to determine our color, and a light processor that applies the lighting to our pixel. A varying variable allows us to use the output of one processor as the input for another. For our vertex processor, this is slightly more special as the value of a varying variable is interpolated as the surface is drawn. Godot's shader language is pretty smart as it will fill in default behavior for parts you leave out. All I'm doing during our vertex processor is calculate a world position. Godot still does the rest. We do more in our fragment processor. Here we start by using the world position we get from our vertex processor to look up a position in our distortion map. We apply a time offset to create a wave effect and then do a second lookup to create a more natural ripple distortion. Now we look up the color of what's underneath the water by using our screen texture. This is a copy of what has been rendered so far and causes our shader to be executed last. There are problems with doing it this way, but it worked good enough for our current purpose. We use our screen UV plus our distortion for our lookup, and then mix that color with our base color. The normal of the surface we're rendering is a key ingredient in how light is reflected and how our surface is shaded, so we need to calculate a normal. We can use our distortion to do so. In the last two lines, we set some PBR settings. I've made a mistake here because I'm using the specular output instead of the metallic output, so only roughness is applied. Note that there is no lighting processor, so all the default lighting logic is applied. And there is our end result. Using a proper camera view, we can see that what's underneath the water is being distorted. We can also see that thanks to our normals, our HDRI sky map is being reflected in the water in unison with our ripples. The plane is still flat, however, so the edges of the water are straight. It is also important to note that using the screen texture is a bit of a fluke, as we could also end up distorting parts of the image that is above the water, say when there is a boat in the water. What we really should be doing is rendering everything that is underwater to a separate viewport, but this requires adding a clipping plane to the viewport system, which currently is not supported. That is all I want to look at today. As you can see from the demo at the start, far more than this is already working, so there's plenty more to review. I'm planning to keep this format where I simply review all that I have been doing. My next video will most likely be about the workflow for creating a level, from exporting grid map assets from Blender to putting a map together. Thanks for watching. Give a like if you enjoyed the video. Till next time.